Good morning. Welcome to our online service here at Leinster Baptist Church. For those who are part of the family and tuning in again, it's great to have you here with us. For those who are tuning in for the first time and you've not been here before, it's great to have you join us. We hope that you find something uplifting and encouraging for you to take away. If you have any questions or you need any advice or support during this time, then please get in touch. You can email or call us and we'd love to see if we can help you in any way that we can. If you're tuning in and you want to be part of the interactive service that we do, where you can have a group chat while the service is going on, before and after and during, if you like, then please tune into that. For those who are part of that, let me just explain some of the way it works. There is a request prayer button. If you click on that, then we'll get an email saying you requested prayer, and we'll type a response to you. And on your bar somewhere, there'll be a little, I think it's a D that comes up, that will say, do you want prayer for anything? How can we help you? So if you want to click that at any point and you feel like you want more prayer or you want someone to get in touch, then you can use that. If you want to send a little love heart because you like something, then I think you can do that. If you want to have a private chat with someone, you can right click on them and do that. So there's more going on. We are still figuring it out and it's all new, but hopefully you found that helpful and encouraging and can make use of that some more. This week we've had some prayer meetings this last week, and we had those on Wednesday. Well done to everyone who managed to get into those. Some of them were very encouraging. I think all of them were encouraging, but some of them have decided they're going to meet weekly to continue that. Some are going to do fortnightly, and so we're going to set up some others. So if you missed it or you want to be a part of it, let us know and we'll plug you into the next round or the next set of groups that are meeting for prayer for us, for the church, for just seeking God together during this time. I've got a bit of a game that we can play today. I hadn't planned it, but just before I sat down to record, I looked down here and there was a blanket and a mouse sat on top of it looking at me. I did get a picture of it, so maybe I'll put that on the screen. But the game is spot the mouse, because he'll probably be scurrying around me at some point, and you can all shout, it's behind you when you see it, because I probably won't notice. If I do jump up, I've either been filled with the spirit or it's gone up my trouser leg, and I'll let you know at the time which of those has happened. Thank you for everyone who responded, providing varnish for the rainbow board that we've got out front, saying thank you, and we're praying for our key workers. We now have an abundance of it, and so thank you for that. We'll get that sealed this week and put back out, along with the notes we've already been sent, the thank yous that we've already been given to put on there, and we'll do that this week. It was VE Day on Friday, a time to celebrate and remember the end of war. Particularly this time, it just felt poignant to remember it. I know it was so different and it wasn't quite what it usually is with the ceremonies and the parades that go on, but it still felt like an important moment just to mark that time, to mark the end of something and the start of something new. And I think it just captures something of the spirit that hopefully is you're feeling at this time, that we do stand together, that we are united in this, and that we are going through this together. There is no one excused from this. We're all a part of it and we're all figuring it out, and it is a struggle for all, but there is always light, there is always hope, there is always tomorrow. And our gospel, the good news of Jesus, always points to that, that there is always, even in the darkest moment, in the most desperate times, light shines. In a moment, we're just going to worship together and think of God, and then we're going to celebrate this light that's in us, this blessing of God that's ours today. I'm just going to pray before we do that. Father, I thank you. I thank you that this week we've been able to commemorate VE Day, the end of war, and the start of something new. And I pray that sensation that we have in that points to something deeper, something greater, this yearning that's in each of us for an end to strife, an end to conflict, an end to unrest, an end to the brokenness that we see and that we feel, and the start of something new. We thank you that this is the news you came to announce, that in Jesus, through his darkest day, through his trial and his suffering, death and war and conflict and sin and the enemy have been defeated. And now love and hope and faith and peace reign. And we press on toward that day. We fix our eyes on that goal. And we ask today, Father, that you would meet with us. We bless you, Lord. And we turn our hearts now to worship you together. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Now like a
I wonder if you felt this week that it's been a bit of a strange one in terms of the lockdown and things that are happening or might happen. We've been a bit back and forth. Apparently today is the day that we've been waiting for, when something will be announced, where we'll hear the news that we need, the time frame that we have, what's going to happen next. At least that's how it started at the beginning of the week. And then very pretty quickly things started to rewind and say, no, don't get too excited. don't think there's going to be too much. Don't go get ahead of yourselves. And so it's been a bit of a back and forth. It was almost like they said, ready, steady, wait. And everyone kind of went to go, but then realized that we were probably going to be in this a bit longer. And who knows what's going to happen? I'm sure you'll hear it later, if it hasn't already been announced, the next steps, the next measures, the next phase, or whatever it is we're going through. But I think that ties in so well with what we're going to look at today. Last week, when we talked about this seeking of God, this hunger just to pursue Him, and to be after Him, and to go after Him Himself and whatever He has to give us, to come open-handed and say, God, we're coming to You. God, we're seeking You. God, we're asking of You, not for anything from You, but just You. And it seemed to have struck a chord, and thank you to everyone who got in touch and responded to that and sent me things and advised things. I'm going to use some of them today. It was really this idea that reasons aren't enough. And that's what perhaps many of us are feeling, that our explanations, our figuring it out, we just can't do it. Hebrews says that faith is the substance of things hoped for, that there are things we can't see, things we can't work out, things we can't comprehend. But faith is substance. Faith is despite that. Faith is trust in a person when reasons say don't carry on. Faith is dependence on a person when everything else says just give up. It gives you something that no reason and no explanation can do. And the story we're going to look at today is well known, but it centers on this idea. We're going to look at Pentecost. And I know it's not Pentecost is at the end of this month, and so we're out of sync with the calendar. But that's kind of the problem with church calendars. They're great because they bring things to mind on a regular basis, so we don't forget key parts of the story. But they also limit the celebration to a certain point of time. So if you need the truth that God is with you and comes in a vulnerable form to be known by all mankind, then sorry, it's not Christmas yet, so you can't have that. Or if you need resurrection, then, well, it's not Easter. And I know we don't really do that, but it does. It limits our celebration or our focus on something to a particular time of year. And so I want to just break that, and we're going to look at Pentecost, despite it not being Pentecost, because it's something that we need to seek today. We don't need it in 3 weeks' time. We need to seek it today and to be after it today. So we're going to be in Acts chapter 1, if you wanted to read along, or just wait for it to come up on the screen. I have this picture that you've got all your concordances and all your commentaries laid out on your coffee table in front of you. So if you haven't, please don't spoil it for me. But in Acts chapter 1, here's what it says. Jesus has risen from the dead, and He's come to His disciples. He's given them this great commission, go into all the nations and baptize them, making disciples in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And then He says this. It says, after His suffering, He presented Himself to them, the disciples, and gave many convincing proofs that He was alive. He appeared to them over a period of 40 days and spoke about the kingdom of God. On one occasion, while He was eating with them, He gave them this command, "Do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift My Father promised, which you have heard Me speak about. For John baptized with water, but in a few days you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit." Then they gathered around Him and asked Him, "Lord, are You at this time going to restore the kingdom to Israel?" He said to them, "It's not for you to know the times or dates the Father has set by His own authority, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be My witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth." I don't know if your theology, your picture of God, allows for the idea of Him every now and then facepalming, you know, and shaking his head. I don't know if you have this idea that God can roll His eyes. I don't know where that lands in theology. But if He could, I imagine this would be a time that He would do it. Jesus comes to the disciples and He shows Himself. He convinces them. He explains what He's done and what He's accomplished. And He explains the kingdom. And then He gives them this command, "Do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift My Father promised, which You heard Me speak about. John baptized with water, but in a few days you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit." He gathers them and He says, wait for the gift. Wait for the thing you've heard me talk about. Wait for the thing. Remember when this all kicked off and you knew John, and John started and John said, but one greater is coming who will baptize you. The one he pointed to. It's the beginning. It's the end. This is the thing that you're after. This is the thing that you need. This is what you've got to wait for. This is my final instruction. Just wait here for it. And the disciples come to them, and here's their response. Lord, are you at this time going to restore the kingdom to Israel? They go, okay, I get it. There's a promise, there's a gift coming. You obviously think this is a big deal, but can you just give us some dates? I might have been on my phone when you covered that, the time frame for this, but I've got my calendar here. Can you just outline, what are we talking about? Making disciples of all nations. I know you told us to do that. Are we talking by this afternoon? Are we talking by next Friday? Is it months? What time frame are we thinking about? And I don't know, I just detect some frustration in Jesus' reply, because he says, it is not for you to know the times and dates the Father has set by his own authority. Some things you don't need to know. Isn't that often the hardest thing to hear? If I tell you I've got something for you, but I'm not going to tell you what it is, automatically your interest is piqued. What is it? What's it for? It's not my birthday. What do you mean you got something? How expensive was it? You haven't spent money. Where did you get it from? We want to know. If I tell you that I've got a secret, I know something, but I can't tell you, well, tell me what it is. You can't keep secrets from me. Come on, share it. Explain it. Come on, don't be... Just open up. Come on, just share it. We're all friends here. I'm not going to tell anyone. Just share it. It's unbearable to know that someone knows something and we don't. And I think that sensation that I'm sure you have and we all have gets to the heart of our humanity. When Jewish people, in the Hebrew reading of Genesis, this beginning story in the Bible, they don't read it as the fall of man and a great rebellion. They see it as a choice. A choice that is in every single person, this inclination of our hearts to choose our ability to comprehend, our grasp of knowledge and insight, over a dependent faith and trust in God. They see it as a story that we all choose, where we say, you know what, I'll figure it out by myself. You know what, I'll figure it out on my own. I'll understand it and I'll get it together and I'll get the plan. Rather than, you know what, I don't even think I'm capable of figuring it all out. I'll have to depend and trust on you, God. And I'm happy to depend and trust on you because of your care and your love for me. They see it as that kind of choice, which is how the story kind of reads. It says that Adam chooses, that they choose the knowledge of good and evil. That's the choice they face, whether they can figure it out by themselves or not. But for many of us, it's the hardest thing to hear. You don't know and you don't need to know. I had a conversation the other day with someone, and we were saying, when are we going to be able to gather as a church? And the answer is, I don't know. And when a business is going to reopen, I don't know. When's the economy going to fix itself? I don't know. And when are we going to be able to see family? I don't know. And at the end of the conversation, I said, it's amazing, isn't it? The cleverest thing we can come up with right now is, I don't know. It's the smartest thing I can say. Anything else is a lie or just conjecture. The smartest thing, the cleverest thing, the true thing is, I don't know. And Jesus says that to the disciples, that you want dates, you want times, you want an explanation. It's not for you to know. And I suspect he still gets frustrated with his church, where he says, what I'm asking you to do, all I'm asking you to do is to wait upon me. To wait upon me. And we go, just tell me, just explain it to me, just direct me, just give us anything. We want to organize, we want to activate, we want to access, we want to learn this, we want to go there, we want to understand this. And I'm all for theology and understanding and teaching, but it's no substitute, it seems, for waiting. We either do it in our strength or his. And once you've done a certain amount in your own strength, you kind of start to ask, there's got to be a better way. I know successful, however you want to measure that, successful churches, successful Christians who have wealth and organization and impact and influence and doing incredible things. And even they are going, there's got to be a better way. And it would seem that Jesus brings it here and says, you've got to wait on me. To be filled with me, to be transformed by me, be equipped by me. And that's hard for me to say, because my testimony is I reasoned my way towards Jesus. And I asked questions and I figured stuff out and I talked with people. But there was a point where I had to say, you know what, I don't know anymore. I can't figure out anymore. I can't answer anymore. I just got to wait on him. Just got to trust him. for some time we've been asking God for insight and wisdom and guidance. And yet here it says, Jesus speaks to the disciples and says, wait for the gift. One translation puts it, the capital P promise. Another way to translate the word is the promised blessing. Not a blessing. We have many blessings all around us, our homes and our friends and our families and our food and the security and safety that we enjoy and the ability to worship. These are all blessings. But Jesus isn't saying that. He's saying, wait for the blessing. The one thing, the gift my Father spoke about, the thing that you need. Not all the other countless things, but the promised blessing. I got sent a hymn this week that reads this. It says, my goal is God himself. Not joy, nor peace, nor even blessings, but himself, my God. 'Tis his to lead me there, not mine, but his, at any cost, dear Lord, by any road. That's what Jesus is saying. It's him. The blessing is God himself by the Spirit filling your heart. And to get that begins with waiting on him. You can't wrench it out of his hands. You can't force it out of him. You can't earn it out of him. You have to wait on it to receive the blessing. Blessing is a concept that we aren't too familiar. We kind of think it's nice words that get said in traditional churches, or it's a thing, you send me £10 and I'll send you a blessing in return. But a blessing is a powerful thing. It's taking the promises and the truth of God and saying, this is yours, will you receive it? And beyond all our prayers and all the things we ask for, what we need more than anything is God's blessing. Not God's blessings, the things he gives us, although they're very nice and wonderful and we enjoy and are grateful for them, but the blessing. To get it though, we have to be emptied. Jesus began his ministry with this truth. He reads out the Beatitudes and he starts each one, blessed is the poor in spirit. Blessed are the hungry and thirsty. Blessed are those who mourn. And each one he's saying there is blessing for those who are emptied in some way. Those who are at the end of themselves in some way, because they are the ones who cry out. He's not saying, blessed are those who are poor in spirit, because actually things are okay. You've got lots of life. You might not be poor in spirit, but at least you've got a home. At least you've got friends. At least you've got family. The Beatitudes aren't, well, every cloud has a silver lining. What they're saying is, you are blessed. You have access. You have the ability to grasp the blessing of God when you are emptied, because you suddenly realize you can now take hold of the one thing he offers more than anything else. When you are emptied of yourself, you are finally ready to take hold of the capital B blessing of God, himself. And that makes you blessed. Not you're doing all right really and you're okay, therefore you're blessed. Not hashtag blessed because you got a nice car. Blessed is, I have the presence and the favor of God in my heart, in my life. God himself with you, in you, filling you, equipping you. And that's what Jesus offers here. Blessing isn't based on ability. It's not. Peter goes on later when he's talking about Pentecost and what's happening. He says, no, this is for your children and for slaves and for absolutely everyone. That God's blessing would be on them, that he would fill them. I heard a sermon by Mike Pilavachi the other day, and as part of it, he's always very funny. He said, you know what, I feel really sorry for some of you. I really feel sorry for some of you are so good looking. Some of you, you're so put together. Your kids, they're like Von Trapp children. Your businesses are so successful. Your Instagram is beautiful. Your hair, your youth, your strength, your charisma, your winning personality, your sense of humor. He says, I pity you, because it's going to be so hard for you to learn to cry out to God. When you've got enough, when you've got enough knowledge and you've got enough things figured out, you don't wait on him. Jesus looks at his disciples and says, it's not for you to know and figure this out. It's just for something for you to receive. It's not for you to ask and schedule in. It's just for you to wait on till you receive. And at the start of his ministry, he looks at his disciples, it says. And I love that. It's not that everyone. It says that he looked at his disciples and said, blessed are you who are poor. Blessed are you who mourn. Blessed are you who hunger and thirst for righteousness. Blessed are you who are empty. You're now ready to be filled with God himself. Jesus chose these people to receive it. I love that because this is Peter we're talking about. The guy who one time got something right, but it was only by accident. Jesus is the Son of God. And then the next phrase gets told, get behind me, Satan, because he gets it wrong. This guy who constantly put his foot on it, and yet in the moment when he's filled with God, is filled to such an extent that he speaks with eloquence, and that he goes to the temple and he shares, and when he explains what this healing of a person, he points all to Jesus. He says, it's not my faith, it's by faith in Jesus. It's not my name, it's in the name of Jesus. It's him who did it, it's him that's accomplished this. And we look at it and go, how do you do that? And he said, I have no idea, but it's him. And he's not after all the ability, he's after him, but this comes. This is John we're talking about. John is, he starts off vengeful. If you know the story, he goes to a village, he gets rejected and says, Jesus, should we call down fire on them to burn them up? And I imagine Jesus goes, were you on Facebook during the Sermon on the Mount? Did you miss the forgiveness bit, or were you just not listening? John, who is competitive. There's the account of the resurrection, and I love the way John tells it, because this is the central moment, the key part of human history. And John takes that moment to say, they get told the tomb is empty, and they run to the tomb, and he feels the need to include in the details that he outran Peter. It's like the biggest moment that's ever happened, and John goes, and by the way, I can run the 100 meters faster than him. And I get that they were fishermen on the same lake, so there's probably a bit of competition from there. But what makes it more bizarre is at the end of John's gospel, he says, you know what, Jesus did many other things and taught other things, and all the books in the world couldn't contain them. So he's only given us a snippet of what Jesus was up to. And yet, in his selective choice of stories, he still chose to include the fact that he's a bit quicker than Peter. And yet later we find him and Peter are walking together hand in hand. They are friends, they are brothers, yeah, united, not by their shared experience, but by the Spirit of God in them. You got Thomas among these people, the guy who's always like, well, come on then, let's go to Jerusalem so we can die with Jesus. And no, I don't believe he's resurrected because I haven't seen it for myself. And yet he ends up his life as a martyr, dying in the name of the one who he doubted and questioned, and yet was filled with, was blessed by, to the extent that he's willing to walk into death itself for his name's sake. These are the people, these ordinary people who are filled, who are blessed by God. Not super saints with halos around their heads shining like they're radioactive, but Tommy and Andy and Matt and Jamie and John Boy. That's who we're talking about. And you and I. This is who Jesus had to work with. This is who Jesus chose. And these are the ones that Jesus says, if you wait, you will be blessed. Not based on your ability or your skill in figuring it out, because if it was down to that, you wouldn't get very far. The fact that Christianity exists, is it baffles historians, because we know the guys who started it. We know where it originated, but they shouldn't have been able to do what they did. Jesus says it's the blessing. When you know you're weak and you're foolish, you know there's no choice but to wait on him. That's the difference that Revelation makes, that Pentecost makes. And you and I, we're all in that place of being empty. We're all equally ignorant. We're all as stupid as each other at the moment. None of us know what's going on or what's going to happen. But it means we're all equally able to receive the blessing of God. Jesus doesn't leave them and say, best of luck, hope you figure it out. Hope things work out well. If you go to the Gospels, Jesus says, go. Go make disciples. But before you go, wait. Ready, steady, wait. Just pause. Just be still. You can't run on fumes. You can't run on my teaching from yesterday. You need his Spirit today to fill you. You can't rely on last week's sermon or yesterday's devotion. You can only rely on the God who's present at every moment. We're not meant to be like fuel tanks that get filled up and then run empty. We're meant to be like hose pipes that only work when the tap is turned on. And something is flowing through us. And so we wait. And that waiting isn't a sitting around, pacing the floor, waiting for God to show up. It's waking up with the idea that we can lean into him with expectation. That we can press into him and wait on him to provide. When you do that, what you'll find when you ask, when you seek, when you rest in him, you may find something stirring in you. Many people will say, I got nothing. Dean, I've done this and nothing happened. The earth didn't move, nothing quaked, nothing happened around me. The sky didn't change colour, nothing happened. And I get that. That's been my experience. That's been many people's experience. And yet most people will say when they look back, nothing happened. But as they walked away, something began to change. As they came away from that seeking and waiting on him, there was a different view. There was a different energy. There was a different perspective. Something had begun to work, and they didn't feel anything in the moment. But as they walked away from it, they sensed something was different. But the key is to wait. I don't have a technique. I don't have, here's what you can expect. All I have is wait on him and do it open-handedly and let him lead where he's going to lead. And sometimes that will be confusing. Sometimes it won't make sense. Sometimes it won't be in your timeline. But that's the whole problem. It's not for you to know those things. Your job is to wait. To tune yourself to his presence. And when you know it, when you know his presence, when you learn his presence, when you breathe his presence, when you yearn for it, it becomes, I guess the only word is Moorish. You realize I can't operate outside of this. Jason Alexander from CLC did a devotion this week where he said he tried to install something or use something on his laptop and it came up, cannot operate because you lack the minimum requirements. And he asked the question, what's the minimum requirement in your life? And here I think Jesus is giving us, here's the minimum requirement for you to operate. To wait on me. All the other things that you might have, good personality and skills and people skills and charisma, all those are fine, but the minimum requirement is to wait on me. My job is to get you to seek that. Your job is then to receive that and pass it on, to be blessed, to be a blessing. That's the whole point, to lead others to seek it. And if it doesn't end up where you think, the destination isn't the goal. It isn't the result that you're looking for, it's him. That's the minimum requirement. My goal is God himself. Not joy nor peace, but himself, my God. And it's his to lead me, not mine. But it does mean giving up something. It does mean giving up certainty. Because the opposite of faith isn't doubt. Doubt is the fuel of faith. Doubt is I cannot see, I cannot comprehend, I don't know the times and dates, but I still trust him. Doubt isn't opposite of faith. Certainty is. Certainty is I've got it figured out. I know everything I need to know. And so I don't need to depend or wait. I'll just do it myself. And of course we can get so far, but we aren't wired for that. We don't have the capacity for that. The disciples have 3 years of Jesus, intense side-by-side teaching and instruction. And Jesus at the end says, that isn't enough. All you're learning, it might be kindling, it might be a pile of wood, but unless it gets set on fire, it means nothing. So in another account, when Jesus walks with the disciples, it says he leads them out of Bethany and he sits with them. They haven't recognized who he is after the resurrection. It says he lifted his hands and he blessed them, and it was then that they saw them. It's when he blesses us. If you were to pin me up against the wall and say, Dean, what is God up to? What's his purpose? What's his goal? What's his aim? My answer would be, he's trying to bless you. He's trying to bless. It's what he's always been trying. It's the only thing God ever tries to do, to bless you with the only blessing, the promised blessing, the thing that he has to offer himself by his spirit. I don't know anything else. Neither do you. But from the beginning, the plan of God, the whole way to get it back on track was to bless. He chose Abraham and says, I'm blessing you. He's been blessing and revealing himself again and again. You and I kind of think, if he answered my prayers, then things would be better. If God just took some advice, if he just listened once in a while, then things would be a bit smoother. And I think God's answer is, if you just receive my blessing, if you just receive what I had to give you, not asking, but just waiting on me. And so to close today, what I wanted to do was to have a blessing for you. Not a couple of nice words just to wrap it up, but for you to receive the blessing. So what I've done is I've asked a couple of people just to read some passages that seem to capture what Jesus invites us to, what he offers to us, what he comes to give us. And for you to hear these words, and then for us just to wait for a moment. just to pause, and it's only 5 minutes for now, and maybe it will lead to more waiting and a more seeking in our hearts, but just for now, just to hear these words and to receive them as a blessing, as God's blessing, as the promised blessing. And for you to take this moment to say, you know what, I keep coming back to Jesus. What are the times and the dates? Jesus, when's this going to work out? Jesus, when's this going to solve itself? And Jesus says, you know what, that's not for you to know. My instruction is for you to wait. Wait till you receive the gift that you need, the promise that you need, the promised blessing that you need. Wait for that. And then we're just going to play a song that I'm sure many of you have already seen this week, but it's a few churches that have come together to sing this blessing, the blessing that God has to give, which is summed up in this: Him and His face shining upon you and Him turning to you. I'll pray, and then we'll just hear these words, and I'll give you the opportunity to receive them as a blessing for you. Father, we ask for so much, we seek so much, we want so much, but we overestimate our own capacity. We overestimate that even if you did explain it all, it wouldn't be enough. We don't need that. It's not for us to know. What we need is the blessing you've come to give us. Yourself, by your Spirit in our hearts. So I ask today, Father, that we'd lay down that desire to know, that pull to understand and comprehend, and that we would receive. And so we come now, Father, open-handed, emptied, poor in spirit, hungry and thirsty, mourning, but in the perfect place, therefore, to receive from you. Fill us afresh by your Spirit. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Come to me, all you who labour and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls.
And without faith it is impossible to please God, because anyone who comes to him must believe that he exists and that he rewards those who earnestly seek him.
Ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and the door will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives. He who seeks finds. And to him who knocks, the door will be opened.
Be still and know that I am God.
From one man he made all the nations, that they should inhabit the whole earth. And he marked out their appointed times in history and the boundaries of their land. God did this so they would seek him and perhaps reach out for him and find him, though he is not far from any one of us.
So do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand.
But may all who seek you rejoice and be glad in you. May those who long for your saving help always say, "The Lord is great."
Draw near to God, and he will draw near to you.
May the Lord bless you and protect you.
The Lord bless you and keep you.
The Lord bless you and keep you.
The Lord bless you and keep you.
May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. May the Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace.
make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. Lord, turn his face toward you and give you peace. The Lord bless you and keep you. Make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you.
The Lord turn his face toward you
and give you peace.
From heaven, this isn't second guessing. We know that we are protected. May the peace that surpasses all understanding be our message. Grace and favors in your nature, in your essence.
May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations,
and your family, and your children,
and the children, and the children. May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations, and your family, and your children, and their children, and their children. May his favor be upon you
and a thousand generations,
and your family, and your children,
and their children,
and their children. May his favor be upon you
and a thousand generations,
and your family, children, and their children,
and their children.
May his presence